I'm Daniel Tearhorse North, is what I'm calling myself these days. I guess I'm a bit of a mischief maker, a bit of a troublemaker. I've been in technology for about 30 years, in the agile end of that for about 20. And I've been using Java for most of that, so probably 20-something years of Java. so there's a fun origin story. So this is late 90s. There's a bunch of us hanging out on IRC. And there were a bunch of public chat servers. One was called EFNet, which was a European one. So a load of people used to hang out on the Java channel. And what we knew so these lovely Russian folks who were working on the editor that was already pretty sophisticated. JetBrains as a name didn't exist yet. They were IntelliJ. They were super proud of their work, and they just wanted to spin it into its own product. So we were very early adopters of this. And by very early adopters, what I mean is the developers would post a link, a URL, into the EFNet Java channel. We would then download the latest build from that link. That was the IDE, right? That was the install process, was pull down this jar and run it. So, and we would do, I remember this really vividly because it annoyed me a lot, kind of in a good way. So we were very into refactoring, very kind of, you know, Martin Fowler style. And I read the book, love the idea, extract method, rename, all that stuff. And so we were basically, myself, particularly a buddy of mine, Joe Walms, were really pushing the edges of what this IDE could do. And we would crash it a lot, right? We would find things that either it didn't do or it didn't do yet. And the developers, English isn't their first language, and they were still punking us in English. Because what they would do is this, is we would say something like, it would be great if you could extract an interface from a class. And they would say, yes, it is. And if they were using future tense, it was a product idea. Yeah, that would be a good idea. If they're using present tense, that means we've already got it. We just haven't released that yet. so things like, so renaming methods is pretty easy. Renaming classes is a bit more fiddly because now you've got to rename files and make that look atomic. Renaming packages is hard, right? On any non-trivial solution, renaming packages is hard because you have to hierarchically recreate an arbitrarily deep file structure, copy a load of files across, change the content slightly, recursively delete, make all that look atomic, right? And if something breaks halfway through, knowing where you are. So it's a really tricky. And so when they got onto renaming packages, that was cool. And we're like, I'd be so cool if we could rename packages. And they say, yes, it is. Come on, release it. Come on. And so there was this whole teaser kind of culture going on. And it was fantastic. And we were huge advocates of it from the get-go. One of my favorite things about IntelliJ, and it's still true now, 20 years later, the people who write it use it. And, you know, it started off with them scratching their own itch, you know, and it still is, right? It's still, there are features in each major release, right? Where I'm like, surely it does everything now. Surely there isn't anything else in Java that you can't. And they'll say, oh, we've just made it so you can do this. And you suddenly go, like, have you never been able to do that? That's such an obvious thing. And they keep on finding new obvious things. So yeah, so I've been a fan for a long time. And you know, the counter argument that, well, you've got NetBeans and you've got Eclipse. And yeah, there are other products that are functionally equivalent. That is absolutely not up for debate. There's practically no other software I use that feels as nice, that feels like an extension of me trying to write some code. So that's my backstory. I'm still a fan. You know, and I have no what's the word? No interest to declare, right? I know a lot of JetBrains people, but and I pay for my license. And in fact, I was offered a free license a while back. And I'm like, actually, I'd rather, you know, thanks, but it doesn't cost much, and I'd rather not, because then I can stay independent and still have opinions. So think of it like it's a tool, right? So now there's tools and there's tools. And if you are someone who uses a set of tools a lot, those tools need to be good tools, because what you don't want to be doing is thinking about the tool. Right? So I'll give you a really basic example. And it's amazing how transformative this has been for me. It's going to sound really bonkers. But about 2 years ago now, I finally bought some decent tools, like home tools. I'm going to buy the smallest tool bag I can find. I'm going to finally get a decent drill driver, right? So I bought a decent drill driver and a couple of other bits and bobs. And then I noticed that I started fixing stuff around the house that I wouldn't have done before. Can you put this picture up for me? Can you rehang that? Can you screw that back on? And I was like, zip, 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 I need some more things to do. Because I finally had tools that I could just pick up, use, they're the right tools in the right toolbox. So let's just hold that metaphor for a minute. So it needs to be the right tools. Well, they need to be the tools that do the right function, right? So my lovely drill driver does three things. It's a drill, it's a hammer drill, but only when you push on it, it goes only when you're pushing. And it's a screwdriver, but with a torque thing. So that means I can confidently use this one tool with a bunch of different bits and not, and even I won't mess it up, and I'm not that hands-on, right? And so now I have a confidence. It gives me a confidence to try stuff that I wouldn't try normally. And so now more stuff gets done around the house. Okay. So as with any tool, if you are unconsciously using that tool, you have much more cognitive availability for solving the problem. Like if you're in a car that's hard to drive, you're spending as much time managing the car as you are navigating. Yeah. Or if you're in a car that you don't trust, like you put on the brakes and sometimes it slows down and sometimes you got to pump them really hard. And, so if it just works, if it always works consistently, and if maybe there's something you've never tried to do before, but when you try it, you can pretty much guess how it's going to work. And then you try it and it does. Right, except it has a little surprise for you that it does this thing a bit better than you thought of because they thought about it first. And there are so many times with IntelliJ that I have this, oh, I didn't even know it did that. Oh, and it's just doing it better than I would have thought of doing it. Right, those sorts of things. I'll give you an example. A few years ago, so we've always had Rename. Right, Rename was one of the first refactorings. They started doing a live rename. So you hit Rename. And as you start typing, it's changing it and also live on the screen, any other occurrence of it are all moving as well, which is a nice visual cue because you can now immediately see where it is on the screen. Now, okay, 10 years ago, probably the compute power on your desktop wasn't up to that. It's not like they didn't have the ideas, that they chose not to do it because it wasn't going to work for most people. So they're keeping abreast of what your desktop can do. And what's nice, and you look at it and you go, that's nice, right? It's not necessary. Rename, you could just have a dialogue pop up and you type in the new name and you hit enter and it does it, right? That's a way to do it. There are many, many ways to do these things. The more you can feel like you are interacting with the tool, the more natural it feels. And the IntelliJ tools, the JetBrains tools generally, obviously IntelliJ is the one I've got by far the most experience of. I used PyCharm quite a bit for a while, and I had a very similar experience with that. I used Golang, and to be honest, I haven't done that much Go, but it kind of felt really familiar, you know? And again, Rider. I got into Rider, and it was like, this is just C sharp in IntelliJ. And so that's one of the things they do really well. So the way I describe it is, and this is anything as well, a good tool is an extension of yourself. You don't think about using the tool, you think about solving the problem, you have the tool. And I've heard blind people say this as well. I've heard in interviews with blind people talking about, how do you find your way around? So once I have my stick, that is part of my body now. I feel through that. And it's visceral. It's a thing. Now, obviously, I don't have that situation, but when I'm using a tool that feels natural to me, I can just get on with it. It'll get out of my way. And I find that there's a lot about IntelliJ that not just gets out of my way, and that's hard, right? Having a tool that gets out of your way is hard. It doesn't just get out of my way, it guides me. And it's pretty good at making the decision about when to get out of my way and when to guide me. And that's hard, right? That kind of usability is really hard. And you can see the sheer amount of effort and energy that's gone into it by how little of it you notice. It's incredibly hard to have a tool as sophisticated as IntelliJ and not notice it. I would say I mean, the short answer is yes, right? The short answer is unequivocally yes. So more productive is interesting. Martin Fowler, I'm going to name drop here. Martin Fowler has a brilliant thing when he's consulting. When anyone uses a comparator, like more or less. You know, we want to become more productive, more effective. And he says, he sits there in this very kind of English way and says, than what? Right? So you need a baseline. What are you going to compare it with? So am I more or less effective, more or less productive in IntelliJ? I would say that I am maximally effective at doing what I'm trying to do, whether it's writing Java or Kotlin or Python or whatever. I am maximally effective using those tools because I have maximum brain capacity available to me to try and solve the problem. So that much I know. I also know that I have effectively a control group of using other IDEs over the years. So at one place, again, it's about in the mid-2000s, there was IBM WebSphere portal server, words that should strike fear in the heart of any enterprise developer from the last decade or so, is based on Eclipse. Now, Eclipse is a fine initiative. The Eclipse Foundation is a brilliant idea. It was one of the first, I mean, I think after Apache Foundation, it was one of the first big open source foundations. You know, and it wasn't just the Eclipse IDE, it was all of the tooling around it. They've done some brilliant things. And I learned it. And it wasn't like I'm fluent in IntelliJ and I'm using Eclipse and I don't feel comfortable with it. I made myself learn it. I do that. I'm a nerd, right? I'll nerd out on something. I was very fluent with Eclipse. I was very confident with Eclipse. And I could make it fly, right? And it was fine. And that's the thing, right? When you're using Eclipse, it's fine. It's not bad, but it's only fine. And what IntelliJ is lovely. And I would much rather use lovely tools than fine tools.